Good morning, my dear students, and I welcome all of you for the day 4 lectures on data structures. So as we did yesterday, before starting the session, let me clarify the queries that were asked by some of the students, and then we'll have a quick recap of what we studied or what we learned in the yesterday's class, and then we'll continue with the Q's topic, and if time permits, we'll start the linguist concepts also. This is how I have planned the session, today's session. So coming to the queries part, yesterday I have got some 4 queries, I think. Yeah, right. So this is a question that is asked by Vijay Kumar Gundla, right? And he is asking where to use this left to right associativity and right to left associativity, which operations are using. This is the question that was asked by Vijay Kumar, and Vijay, the answer is a straightforward thing, and I have explained the concepts of this right to left and left to right associativity clearly in the day 2 class, and you might be having some doubts on what operators are having the left to right associativity and which operators are having the right to left associativity, right? So in such case, you have to go and get the C concepts. That means you will find the operators, precedence and associativity in any of the textbook of the C programming language, and similarly you can browse the internet so that you can get the table where the operators are listed and then the precedence of those operators and the left to right and right to left associativity is given in a table, right? So for you to get clarification, let me show you the screen, right? So you can see the screen, right? And here is the 1 minute, and here is the thing, a table that is displayed before you, which gives the operator and the description of the operator and the precedence level and the associativity, right? So while coming to this precedence level, this parenthesis and functions and period operator and the arrow operator and postfix increment and postfix decrement, all these occupy the first level of precedence. That means they are having the highest precedence and they have the left to right associativity. Similarly, when coming to the second level of precedence, as I told in the class, that the unary operator such as unary plus, unary minus, prefix increment, prefix decrement, logical not, ones complement, and similarly the exponentiation operator, all these comes in the second level of precedence and they have the right to left associativity. And after that we have different levels like arithmetic operators, multiplication, division and modular division, arithmetic addition, arithmetic subtraction, and in the next level we have left shift, right shift, and then we have relational operators like less than or equal to, greater than or equal to, and then we have the comparison operators, equal to, not equal to. All these operators, you can observe here that all these operators are left to right associative only. This was clearly explained, and I already told that very few of the operators, for example, if you take the second level of precedence, unary plus and unary minus, those set of operators like something like 9 operators will have right to left associativity, and if you come to the level precedence level of 14, like assignment operators is equal to and shorthand assignment operators such as star equal to, division equal to, all these operators have right to left associativity. For the remaining operators, we have left to right associativity. This was clearly explained in the class, but not an issue. We need to clear the doubts, right? So, but out of all these operators we have, we will be using only few operators, the very limited operators, like only 5 operators, like exponentiation, multiplication, which is represented with star, division, which is represented with a by symbol, and addition and subtraction. We will be using only these 5 symbols as the infix operators, right? For the infix operations, expressions. One minute. So this is the table that you can see, and you have to by heart it. There is no other option, and there is no need to by heart all these symbols, right? I am telling you that we have only 5 different operators, where the exponentiation operator is only having right to left associativity, and the remaining operators such as multiplication, division, addition and subtraction are having left to right associativity. You please remember these 5 operators only. No need to remember all these operators, right? So, but you have to remember that this unary operators are right to left, and similarly the assignment operators is right to left associative. But the remaining operators, it is left to right associative by default, right? And coming to the second question, which is asked by one student, that is Ravi Pudi Chandana, and she is asking that, sir, this much of time not given in exam, right? Then how we can solve this type of problems easily? Is there any other way to do this postfix, prefix and infix expressions, right, to solve easily and quickly? Dear Chandana, that I think you have to follow the yesterday's class, where I have discuss the conversion of infix to postfix expression using conventional methods, that is by using the stack, and finally I have given the explanation or the shortcut method for converting the infix to postfix expression. For that purpose, let me give you one example how we can do these things in a quick fashion, right? So let me take a simple example, very simple example, and how much time it is taking to convert by using my shortcut method, let me explain. Let me take the first postfix expression as a plus b star c. This is very simple expression which consists of two operators. If you go by conventional method, you have to take the stack like this, which consists of some specified indexes, a specified size, and you have to take the output, and you have to apply the algorithm which I have discussed in the classroom. If it is an operand, place it in the output. If it is an operator, check whether the stack is empty or not. If the stack is empty, just push it and increment the pointer. If it is an operand, place it in the output and increment the pointer. If the stack is not empty, you have to compare the precedence of star operator with the plus operator, right? So if the star operator is having highest precedence, then the precedence of the symbol that is lying on the top of the stack, then you can simply push it. Otherwise, you have to pop the symbol and then place it in the output, and you have to insert the, or you have to push the new symbol. But here the star operator is having the highest precedence, so you just push it onto the stack. Not an issue. Increment the pointer. Now here the symbol is C. Since it is operand, place it in the output. And this is the end of the expression. We are left with two symbols in the stack. So what you have to do? You have to pop each and every symbol and place it in the output. Pop star and place it in the output. Pop plus and place it in the output. So this is the conventional method, which may take almost 1 minute, right? Or less, maybe less than 50 seconds, let us assume. But for the shortcut method, which I have explained in the yesterday's class, since there are two operators, plus and star, star is having the highest precedence. Therefore, this sub expression has to be evaluated. So in the first step, what you will do? A plus BC star. Why? Because postfix means you have to place the operator after the operands, right? So it becomes BC and star. You have to make a mark that this particular BC star, the evaluated sub expression, should be treated as a single operand. Therefore, we are left with only one operator and you convert it. A, B, C star plus, right? So this is the postfix expression. Like that, if you go by the conventional method, it almost takes around 1 minute or less than 1 minute for you converting this infix to postfix, right? But if you go for the shortcut method, it is just one step. But if you practice more and more, by looking at this example, I can directly write like this, right? Since star is having this highest precedence, it becomes BC star, and after that we have only one operator and ABC star plus. This is the postfix expression. So this is how you can solve it. This is the method I have explained yesterday, and I have explained this particular method with 6 different examples, starting from the very basic example of infix expression, like taking only one operator, and then I have gone to the 2 operators and again 2 operators with same precedence, and then we have discussed what happens if the precedence of operators is equal and then if the associativity is left to right. For that we have taken one example, and if the associativity is right to left, we have taken another example. I have explained it clearly, and finally we have explained 2 different examples which consists of multiple operators, and that too including the parenthesis and nested parenthesis. Everything was clearly explained in yesterday's class, and what I request the students is to please follow the classes without missing a single second, right? I know that it is very difficult task to follow the 2 hours of classes, but if you want to learn the concepts, I request the students not to skip not even a single second, right? So if you skip something, then you will be missing something, right? So for this given expression, coming back to the example, A plus B star C, it has taken me just 2 seconds, right? A, B, C star plus. But if it is a complex expression, then you need to take more time. But going through the conventional method will cost you more, and it will take more time. That's the reason why I have explained this shortcut method, right? So if you have any doubts, you can ask me. Still you have any doubts, you can ask me without any hesitation. That is what we are here for, and I request all the students to practice more and more examples such that you can get acquainted to this particular shortcut method and you can solve it on your own within no time. This is the answer that I think, Chandana, I have answered your question. And coming to the third question, which is asked by Adurthi, Sri Adurthi, and the student is saying that the screen is not clear and it is somewhat blur. Dear student, we are working on this particular thing that our systems are connected with high speed internet, which is around 60 Mbps offline and around 100 Mbps, 60 to 100 Mbps offline are there for at our end. But why are the answer to your question is, maybe you are working with the mobile phones. The data that is supported by the bandwidth that is supported by your mobile is not that much sufficient to access the contents of this particular class, and that's the reason why your screen is not clear. But if you access or if you download the videos after you complete this class, then you will have the clear screen, that's for sure. And I request you to have the good bandwidth and to move yourself to a good location where the signals are very strong and you can get good access to the internet, right? And coming to the last question, which was asked by Manjunath. Hi sir, this is Manjunath from JNTUP. I had a doubt rise, like how can we do the conversion of postfix to infix and prefix to infix? Thank you, Manjana. This is a very good question, and most of the time when you go to the classroom or the undergraduate classes of data structures, applications of data structures will be discussed with an example of converting the infix to postfix expression and evaluation of postfix expression. Nobody will touch how you can convert the infix to prefix. Nobody will discuss how you convert the postfix to infix or how you convert the prefix to infix, right? So this is a very good question asked by Manjunath, and it takes some time to explain me. I will explain right now, but it takes some time. And I thought of explaining these extra topics as a last part of my discussion, but anyhow, the question was raised by one of our student, right? So I need to answer it. Let me go through the explanation first. Right. Let me explain. We are clear about one concept, two concepts, right? First one is how to convert the infix to postfix. We have a very good algorithm and we have done lot of examples on this. And the second one is we are familiar with evaluation of postfix expression. Evaluation of postfix expression. This is also a very simple algorithm. We have done two or three examples on this. And now the question is how to convert the infix to prefix by using the conventional method. I have given the shortcut method how to convert the given infix expression to prefix expression. But this is where we are discussing how to convert the infix to prefix expression. The point here is the students, there are no particular algorithms specially defined for prefix algorithm, like prefix expressions. Like whenever you come across the prefix, there is no special algorithm. You have to make use of the already existing postfix algorithms only. Okay, we will see three different topics in this particular session where you will come to know why there are no specific prefix algorithms, right? And why we are making use of the postfix algorithms, what postfix algorithms are used for this particular prefix things, right? So coming to the first one, infix to prefix, very simple algorithm. We know the algorithm for infix to postfix, right? The same algorithm is used to convert the infix to prefix also. But before that, what you have to do is you have to, let me go for the algorithm. So this is the algorithm. In the step one, you have to reverse the given infix algorithm, infix expression. The first step, what you have to do is you have to reverse the given infix expression. Whatever infix expression is given, that you have to reverse it. That means you have to write the expression from the right hand side. Right? We'll see with different examples, not an issue. And after that, in step two, you apply the infix to postfix conversion algorithm. So for converting the infix to prefix, first we have to reverse the infix expression, and then you have to apply the infix to postfix expression algorithm only. But please make a note here that whenever you reverse the infix expression, so there is a slight change in this particular postfix conversion algorithm in case of operators, right? For example, if you take plus and minus, these two operators are having the equal precedence. Whenever you have equal precedence, you have to go for the concept of associativity. But the associativity of plus and minus says that it is left to right. But since you have reversed this infix expression, what you have to do is you have to convert, or you have to use the associativity of this plus and minus not as L to R. Since you have reversed, you have to reverse this thing also. So it becomes R to L, right? So this is the only discussion, or what is the only contradictory part for this infix to postfix conversion algorithm, right? So after this, so if you make this thing using stacks, for example, if plus is there and minus is the incoming symbol, and if you want to push the things, or you have to check the left to right associativity. According to left to right associativity, the equal precedence operator cannot lie on top of the another operator, right? So in such case, you have to pop and place it in the output, and again you have to push it into the stack. But if you consider the right to left associativity, what you have to do? The right to left associativity says that equal precedence operators can lie on top of each other. Therefore, if you have plus and you are coming across with this minus, you just place it on the top. This is the simple contradiction. You have to note it down and you have to make it according to this right to left. So whenever there is a left to right associativity, it is converted to right to left. Whenever there is right to left, it is converted to left to right. This is the simple change. You have to make a note of it. And after getting the postfix expression, you have to reverse that result again to get the prefix. Simple thing. So there is no specific prefix algorithm that is described for the conversion of infix to prefix. You have to make use of the same algorithm, that is infix to postfix postfix expression only. But we have to make a note that the equal precedence operators, when you come across the equal precedence operators, you have to go for the associativity. If it is left to right, you have to go with the right to left, and if it is right to left, and you have to go with the left to right. So let me go with one example. The first example that I have taken is a very simple example, which is a infix expression. So according to algorithm of converting the infix to prefix, what you have to do? You have to reverse the expression. So you start scanning the given expression from right to left. So the first symbol is C, next is star B plus A. So this is reversing. And after that, you apply the infix to postfix conversion algorithm, right? So we'll go with the shortcut method without going for the conventional method of using stacks, right? If you go for stacks also, there is not an issue. Let me go for the conventional method, right? For example, you take this stack and you take the output, right? So the first symbol is C, which is an operand, place it in the output. Next one is star, push it into the stack. Next is B, place it in the output. Next is plus. Since plus, the incoming operator plus is having the less precedence than the top of the stack element, so you have to pop it and place it in the output, right? And then you push this element plus. Now the current symbol is A, place it in the output. We are left with only one symbol in the stack. See, after reaching the end of the expression, you place it in the output. This is how we convert the given prefix expression, infix expression, into postfix. And the last step, what you have to do is you have to reverse the obtained result. That is, you have to reverse the postfix expression that is obtained. So you go from this side, and the first symbol is plus. After that, it is A, and then it is star, and then it is B, and then it is C. Simple thing. Even if you convert this A plus B star C, since it is star is having highest precedence, it becomes star BC, A plus star BC. After that, you convert this plus, it becomes plus A star BC, which is same as that of the result obtained for us, right? So if you want to go with the conventional method, let me take another example, the second example, which is, listen carefully, this is very important example. The given expression, the infix expression, is A plus B minus C star D by E. Okay. Let me divide this screen into two parts. This left part is for conventional method, and the right part is the shortcut measure. So first you have to reverse the given infix expression. How you will reverse? You start from the right hand side. So you have come across the first symbol as the closing symbol. If it is a closing symbol, you make it as a opening symbol. That's it. If it is a opening symbol, you make it as a closing symbol. That's the point you have to remember here. Now it becomes E by D star C. Since it is a opening symbol, you make it as a closing symbol. Minus, again opening symbol converted into closing symbols converted into opening symbol, and then it is B plus A, and the left symbol is converted with right symbol. Now you go with the stacks concept, since it is a conventional method, right? So you take the stack and you take the output like this and you start scanning it. So if it is a left symbol, you push it onto the stack. Next, it is E, place it in the output. Next one is division, you place it on the top of the left symbol. Next symbol is D, place it in the output. Next symbol is star, and compare the precedence of this star with division. Both are equal. So according to the associativity rule of the star and division, it is left to right. But what I told, since you have reversed the infix expression, you have to reverse this associativity also. At this particular point, they become right to left. If it is right to left, equal precedence operator can lie on top of the other operator which is having equal precedence. So we have to push it, right? Otherwise, if it is left to right, we have to pop this element division and place it in the output, and then you have to push it into the, push the new symbol into the stack. But since you are changing the associativity to right to left, equal precedence operator can sit over the other operator, right? Now it is C, place it in the output. It is closing symbol. Whenever you come across the closing symbol, you have to pop each and every element from the stack until the left symbol, and you place it in the output. So you pop this star. You pop this star and place it in the output. And then you pop this division and place it in the output, right? And after that, you have to remove this left symbol also. Now the stack is empty. Now the next symbol that is red is minus. You simply place that minus into the stack. Why? Because the stack is empty. Next, you have come across the left symbol. Push it onto the stack. Next symbol is B. Place it in the output. Next symbol is plus. Place on top of the left symbol. Next symbol is A. Push it, place it in the output. The next symbol is the right symbol, right? Right parenthesis. So in such case, you have to remove the, or you have to pop the operators from the stack. So you pop plus and place it in the output, and then you have to remove this one, and here you have reached the end of the stack. Whenever you reach the end of the stack, if there are any symbols that are left over on the top of the stack or in the stack, you can simply pop those elements one by one and place it in the output. So it becomes a minus, right? So you remove this. Now it becomes minus. So this is the postfix expression for the reversed infix expression. So in the third step, you reverse this expression, right? It becomes minus plus A B by star C D E. Let me check with the shortcut method whether it is true or not. So the given expression is A plus B minus C star D by E. So we have the parentheses here. If there are parentheses, you have to first evaluate the parentheses part first. Either you can go from here or you can go from here, right? Let me solve this first. It becomes AB plus, and I make a mark that such that I can identify it as a single operand. Minus, we have to evaluate this parenthesis, right? So we have two different operators. What are these two operators? That is star and division. Both are having equal precedence, but and then you have to go for the left to right associativity. So this CD should be evaluated first, which becomes CD star, and then this E should be evaluated later. Then it becomes CD star E by E. We need to convert it into prefix, right? Let me convert it into prefix, which is nothing but this becomes plus AB. I am putting a mark to identify it as a single operand. Minus, after that, this sub expression within the parenthesis has to be evaluated. We have two operators, which are star and E. Since the associativity is left to right, you have to do like this. It becomes star CD by E, right? In the next step, it becomes plus AB minus this division comes here, division star CDE. And this is one operand and this is another operand. And in the final step, it becomes minus plus AB by star CDE. So, the shortcut method which we have applied to convert the infix to prefix expression is this one, and by applying the conventional method is this one. Now you can observe the difference between the time which you have solved this particular problem. The solution is very fast when you apply these shortcut methods. So the result is same, and I request the students not to go for the conventional methods to save time, right? So you can try this third example. If you want to have some clear idea, you try both this conventional method as well as the shortcut method. Let me give the shortcut method first. I don't want to go for the conventional method, right? I directly go with the shortcut method. So this expression, let me take the expression once again. A plus B cap C star D plus E cap F. So this is the expression that is given. It consists of the parenthesis. So you have to evaluate the parenthesis first. Within the parenthesis, we have two operators, that is plus and exponentiation. Out of these two operators, we have the exponentiation operator having the highest precedence. Therefore, that sub expression, that is B cap C, should be evaluated first. Since it is a prefix expression, what I am doing is I convert this sub expression B cap C into prefix expression. Therefore, it becomes cap BC. I make a mark of it to identify it as a single operand, and this is the expression after converting the sub expression. Next one, again we have this parenthesis, you convert it, it becomes A plus plus A cap B C, mark it as an operand, and then it is star D plus E cap F, right? And we have, how many operators we have? We have three operators. Star is one operator, plus is second operator, and cap is another operator, right? Out of these three operators, the exponentiation operator is having the highest precedence. Therefore, you have to evaluate this sub expression first. You continue the process. It is plus A cap BC star B, and this is plus and this is cap EF, right? Mark it as this single operand, and we are left with only two operators, that is star and plus. Star is having highest precedence. Now it becomes star, the first operand is plus A cap B C, and the second operand is D. Mark it as single operand. It becomes plus cap E F. This is second operand. So after converting, it becomes plus star plus A cap B C D cap E and F. So this is the prefix expression that is obtained. Maybe if you practice more, I can directly write the answer while looking at this expression. Why? Because this all depends on the practice, right? For example, if I want to make it as an expression, maybe two steps is enough, like plus A cap B C, and here we have cap E F, and then we have this star. Therefore, make this star like this and D, and then we have this plus, make it like. So the prefix expression is plus star plus A cap B C D cap E F, which takes less than 30 seconds if you practice more. So this is the shortcut method, and I request students to practice more examples, right? So this is for understanding purpose. Why I have given all these steps is this is for understanding purpose, and you should not miss or you should not do any mistakes in the real examinations while you take the real gate examinations, right? This is also correct method. You can directly write if you have more and more practice, right? And coming to the second example, which was asked, second concept which was asked by Manjunath, postfix to infix conversion, right? There is no special algorithm for postfix to infix conversion. We have to make use of the same algorithm, which is nothing but evaluation of postfix expression. The same algorithm is used, no change, but one or two steps may vary, right? Let us look at the example or the algorithm to convert the postfix expression to infix expression. The step one remains the same for both the evaluation of postfix expression and conversion of postfix expression to infix. The step one is you create an empty stack and start scanning the postfix expression from left to right. Okay. And then the second step is remains the same. If the element is an operand, push it onto the stack. Right. So, as I told in the previous class, the stack that is being used for this evaluation of postfix as well as conversion of this postfix to infix is operand stack. Why? Because the name is given based on the contents which you are storing in the stack. In this algorithm, you are storing the operands inside the stack. Therefore, it is called as operand stack. But in the previous algorithms for converting the infix to postfix and for converting the infix to prefix, we are making use of operator stack. Why? Because we are storing the operators. Therefore, that stack is called as a operator stack. Right? So, there are some questions, direct questions which are asked on these particular topics. What is the type of stack that is used for converting the infix expression to postfix expression? It is an operator stack. Similarly, there is another question like what is the stack that is used for evaluation of postfix expression? It is an operand stack, right? Similarly, here also for converting the postfix to infix expression, since we are using the evaluation of postfix algorithm only, we are again making use of this operand stack only. Simple concept. So, if it is an operand, push it onto the stack. If it is an operator OP, this is important. There in the evaluation, what you are doing, you are popping twice and then you are storing in operand 2 and operand 1 respectively, and you have to calculate operand 1, OP, operand 2, and whatever result you get, that should be pushed onto the top of the stack, right? The same thing happens here, right? If it is an operator, you pop twice and get operand 2. So, whatever element that is popped first, it should be placed in, first popped element is placed in operand 2 and the second popped element is placed in operand 1, right? And you have to calculate this thing. This is the simple difference between these algorithms. You have to calculate this thing. Operand 1, OP, operand 2. This is not a result. You won't get any single value. You will get a string like A plus B or B star C. Like that you will get some string. So what you will do is after getting this string, you encapsulate the string within the parentheses like this. You just add these parentheses, left symbol and right symbol, and then push it back to the stack. Right? This process should be repeated until the expression is ended. If the expression is ended, then the value that is present on the top of the stack will be the final answer. The same algorithm, no change, except that you have to convert it into a string and you have to add some parentheses. Right? So this is how we convert. Let us go for some examples here. This is the first example and this is the second example, right? Right. So this is the postfix expression that is given, that is A, B, C star plus. According to the algorithm, you take a stack, empty stack. Okay, I have taken the empty stack. let the size of this stack be just 3 elements with index starting from 0 to 2 and ending with 2. So you take the output, it's not output, right? So according to the algorithm, you scan the given postfix expression from left to right. If it is an operand, you push it onto the stack. If it is next, increment the pointer, it is pointing to B. See, it is also an operand, push it onto the stack. Increment, it is C, operand, push it onto the stack. Increment, now it is an operator. Now according to step 2.2 of the previous algorithm, you have to pop twice the stack and then you have to make an string like this. So you pop the first element and place it in operand 2. So the operand 2 is nothing but string C, and you again pop it and the operand 1 becomes B, right? You have to calculate a string like this: operand 1 operator and operand 2. What is the operator here? We have the operator as star. Therefore, you have to make a string like this. It becomes B star C. After making the string, you have to encapsulate this string inside the parenthesis. And this is the result we have obtained. And you have to push back this thing again back into the. So this is removed and this is removed. Now you have to push back this expression into the stack. Now it becomes B star C, right? After that, you increment the pointer. It is pointing to plus. Since it is an operator, again you make the same things like. Right. Now the operator is plus. The operand 2 is the first element that is popped, which is nothing but B star C. And the operand 1 is nothing but the second element that is popped, which is A. You make the string like this. That is operand 1, which is A, and operator plus, and then it is B star. Right. After that, we encapsulate the entire result into the parenthesis. Now what happens? This is removed, this is popped, and this is popped. And you have to push the new result onto the top of the stack, right? It becomes A plus B star C. Now you have reached the end of the expression. That is, whatever element that is present on the top of the stack is the correct infix expression. Therefore, for the given postfix expression ABC star plus, the correct or the corresponding infix expression is A plus B star C, right? Very simple example. So there exists no shortcut method. You have to go for the conventional method only. You have to go for the stacks only, right? Similarly, if you take this particular example, what happens? So it is A and it is B. Now you have come across plus, the next symbol is plus, and then you have to make the operation A plus B and push it onto the stack like this, and then we have C, we have D, and then it is star. Again, pop the elements and make the expression like this, which is nothing but C star D. And we have one more element E, and you have come across this one. Now what it becomes? So you remove it. It becomes by E. Now we have one more operator, that is minus. What you have to do? You have to pop these elements, right? So this is operand 2 and this is operand 1. It becomes A plus B. Operator is minus, and then it is C star D by E. Right? And then you push this result. Okay, you can remove the extra parenthesis, right? So this expression will be equal to A plus B minus C star D by E. right? So this is how we convert the given postfix expression into infix expression, which is a straightforward algorithm with some modifications of evaluation of postfix expression algorithm, right? So after this, the last topic which was asked by Manjunath is how to convert the prefix to infix. Dear students, please remember that whenever you come across the concept of prefix, you just remember that there is no algorithm for prefix. So whatever algorithm that lies for the postfix expression, you just reverse it and then make use of the existing algorithm. Right? We have seen the concept of how to convert the postfix to infix. So coming to prefix to infix, that means conversion of prefix to infix, you have nothing to do. As a first step, you have to reverse the given postfix expression and then you have to apply the algorithm of postfix to infix algorithm. But while making use of that algorithm, since you have reversed the given prefix expression, if you reverse the prefix expression, it is nothing but a postfix expression. If you reverse the postfix expression, it is a prefix expression, right? So since you have reversed the prefix expression, the result is nothing but a postfix expression. We know the algorithm to convert postfix to infix. So you apply the same thing. But remember that since you have reversed it, there is some change over here. In the previous algorithm, you have to pop twice whenever you come across the operator, and the first popped element is placed in operand 2. First popped element is equal to operand 2. And the second popped element is operand 1. Right? But here the scene reverses. There is a reverse operation, that is, the first popped element will be operand 1 only, and the second popped element is operand 2 only. So the remaining things remains as it is. That right? There's no problem, right? So this is the only point you have to remember, that the first popped element will become the operand 1 and the second popped element will become the operand, right? Now let us take the example. The first example that is given, the prefix that is given is plus A star B C, right? As a first step, you reverse the prefix expression, you reverse the prefix to get the postfix. Reversing means go from the right hand side, same thing, it becomes C B star A plus. Now you apply the postfix to infix conversion algorithm, right? You take the stack, it is C and it is B, and you come across this star, so this expression becomes so this is C and this is B, right? So you pop the first element and place it in operand 1 but not operand 2 as that of the previous algorithm. So it becomes B and operand 2 becomes C and the operator is star. We apply the thing, B becomes B star C, right? Let me take a bigger stack. So it becomes B star C, and then the next symbol is A, push it onto the stack, the next symbol is plus, pop twice and place the first element as operand 1 which is A and the second element as operand 2 which is B star C. You make the operation, that is, this is plus, right? So it becomes A plus B star C. You make it into the parenthesis and again you push it onto the final result is, it is A plus B star C, right? Since you have reached the end of the expression, the result that is present on the top of the stack will be the required infix expression, that is nothing but A plus B star C. For explanation point of view, it takes lot of time, but if you practice it, you can solve it within very less time, right? You can try the second example. First thing is you have to reverse it. That is, it becomes EDC star by BA plus minus, right? So EDC will become, and for this it becomes C star D, and then after this becomes E by E, and after that we have B and A. Above B and A we have plus, that is it becomes A plus B, and after that we have minus this one. So it took less than 1 minute for me to solve this example. The direct answer is given. So this is how we convert the given infix expression to prefix expression. That two important points you have to remember is the prefix expressions does not have any specific algorithms. You have to make use of the already existing postfix algorithms only with some different changes. And the second important point that you have to remember is whenever you come across the prefix expressions, you remember that the first thing you have to do is you have to convert it into the postfix expression. How you convert the postfix expression means you simply reverse the given in prefix expression. Then you get the postfix expression, and then you have to apply the postfix expressions algorithm, right? So Manjunath, I think I have cleared you all the concepts, and I hope that I made a sense for you, and thank you for questioning me on this particular topic so that I got a chance to explain more topics. Three more important topics or three more extra topics may be useful for the GATE examination. If you learn the concepts, you can answer these things, right? So that's all about the queries session. Only 4 queries. I have answered all the 4 queries. And before entering into the quick recap of yesterday's class, I request all the students that some of my students asked me that, sir, is there any shortcut method for all the things in the GATE, right? This is something very critical question and something absurd that there does not exist shortcut methods for all the methods, for all the concepts. Okay, if there exists any shortcut method for any concept, then I will explain it clearly with taking lot of examples and by taking lot of time. Why? Because I want to make my students understand the basic concepts, right? When the student asked me the question of is there any shortcut method to solve all the concepts, right? I felt pity that the thing is that we are habituated for the instant things in the real world, right? But the instant things does not work for the competitive examinations. Dear students, I request you that you learn the concepts first. Like yesterday, some students have asked that you please concentrate on the questions for the interviews also, right? I answered them that I said that whenever you learn the concepts, you will definitely answer whatever question he asks, whether it can be a difficult question or intermediate level question or basic level question, right? So don't get accustomed or don't get habituated to the instant methods or instant things, right? So there's a difference between the training and coaching. We are not training here, right? Training is something like you transfer the knowledge, whatever knowledge we have. It depends on just telling the things. Of course, I accept that the online classes comes under the category of training only, where we transfer lecturer will transfer or the resource person will transfer the knowledge, and it all depends on telling only, and it is learning focused. But we are trying our maximum, we are trying our level best to make this training session as a coaching session. The difference is, in coaching session, we will enhance the knowledge, right? We don't just transfer the knowledge. And it depends on asking. That's the reason why the authorities have provided you the Google form where you can pose a lot of questions for the faculty members, right? Thereby, we can give answers to you and we can enhance the knowledge that is present inside you, right? This is development focused. Coaching is development focused. So I request the students to please be patient until you get to the phase two. As I told that in the earlier session and the day one session itself, I am making my lecture to be planned in such a way that the phase one is complete discussion of the theoretical concepts and the problematic concepts, right? And in phase two, we'll come across some practice questions, MCQs, where all the topics or all the concepts that are discussed in phase one will come into our questions, and then it will also serve as the revision part also. Similarly, the phase three is very important, where we'll discuss a lot of gate questions, previous gate questions, and I can assure you that whenever you follow these concepts, this phase one, you learn the basic concepts and you try to apply those concepts. So you can easily answer the phase two and phase three. Definitely you will come to know that there is an advantage of going through this phase one, right? That's for sure. And so I request you to concentrate on phase one. You learn the concepts. For example, if I directly jump, I can jump directly into the questions and I can make you to practice more and more questions. But the thing is that without knowing the basic concepts, even though if you go and practice one model, if the same model appears in the examination, you can answer it. But if there is some twist in the question, without having the base of the knowledge or without having the base of the concepts, you cannot understand the twist of that question and you cannot answer those questions. That's the difference between training and coaching. If I train you for some particular models, you will be trained on those questions only and you can answer those questions. The questions are the same patterns. But if something happens, like if he gives some large question, then you cannot answer it, right? Why? Because you don't know the basic concepts. So again, I'm emphasizing you students that please be patient until phase two and phase three. You please concentrate on phase one, where you learn lot of concepts and where you can apply these concepts in phase two and phase three. And as I told that phase two and phase three serves as a revision for phase one. So that's all. And this is my humble request to all the students. And let me have a quick recap of what we have studied yesterday or what we have learned yesterday. Yesterday we have gone through the applications of stacks, that is second application, conversion of infix to postfix with a shortcut method. And we have gone through the third application, that is postfix expression evaluation. We have done two examples and then we have jumped into the concept of queues. That is, we have discussed the definition of queues, which says that it is a linear data structure where insertions takes place at one end and deletions takes place at the other end. The end where we insert the elements is called as the rear end or the last end, tail end also. There is another name called as tail end. But the end where we delete the elements is called as the front end, which is also called as head, and which is also called as first end, right? And we have discussed the various queue operations like NQ and DQ. NQ means inserting an element at the rear end of the queue is called as NQ. You have to call it as an NQ only. Don't call it as insertion into the queue, right? And then the DQ operation, which says that removing an element from the front part of the queue is called as the DQ. And we have discussed two concepts, which is queue overflow and queue underflow. Queue underflow means if you want to remove an element or if you want to dequeue an empty queue, then it raises a situation which is called as dequeue, which is called as queue underflow, right? And coming to queue overflow, if you want to enqueue a full queue, whenever the queue is full and if you try to insert an element onto the queue, then it becomes a queue overflow condition, right? Now, coming to the applications, let me have one real-time example where you can observe these queues. 1 minute. Right. So here we have discussed these few operations, and it is also called as FIFO data structure, where FIFO stands for first in first out data structure. Otherwise, it is also called as last in last out, like LILO, right? So this is an example where you can come across the queue data structure or queue type of operations in our daily life. For example, assume that you have there is a bank like SBI, and whenever a customer wants to have a service like withdraw or deposit money, he will go to the bank and he is the bank teller. Bank teller is a person who gives you the service like depositing, or who helps you in depositing and withdrawing the money and some other transactions like that. So assume that he is the bank teller that is sitting in the counter, and there are four customers, 1, 2, 3, 4, and they are standing in a queue. So this is an example of queue, and this is the rear pointer and this is the front pointer, right? And he is the bank teller who will give service to this. For example, if this person P1 wants, he came to bank for some depositing some 10,000 rupees. So he is the first person to visit the bank, right? So he stands first in the queue. So this particular person will be the first person to be given service by the bank teller. Therefore, the first inserted element, he is the first person to get into the queue, and he will be the first person to go out of the queue, right? That's the reason why the queue is called as a FIFO data structure, right? For example, assume that there is another person who came to the bank, like this fifth person, he is entering, right? If he is not following the queue data structure, and if he wants to go to the first part, right? One minute. If this person wants to go to this place and he wants to stand here, then he will get screwed from the remaining persons, right? So whenever you go to some bureaucracies or bank or some movies and whatever it may be, it is habituated, and it is a concept that a queue is being used in this to have the these things, right? And so this is where the element should be added. That means the new person P5 is to be always added at the rear end, then there is no problem at all. So he is the last person that is inserted, that is last inserted, and he will be the last person to be outputted. That's the reason why it is called as LILO data structure also. Now, when our new people enter into the queue, they should be always be placed at the rear part of the queue. That is how the NQ operation is defined, right? Coming to the next part, which is nothing but the DQ operation. Let us assume that P1 has deposited some 10,000 rupees into the bank, and he has given the service, and then he has completed his task, right? And then he has to move like this. He has to move outside the queue, and the second person P2 will move front, and he will be getting service from the bank teller. Like that, first P1 will be serviced, and then P2, and then P3, and then person 4, and then person 5 will be serviced. So this is how the DQ operation will be performed. So since P1 is entering into the queue as the first person, he will be the first person to be outputted, right? So this is the DQ operation. And coming to this example, this is very good example where there are probabilities. There is a probability that these type of questions may be asked in the gate examination, right? So initially he has taken a queue. You take 1 minute. You take a queue of size, some fixed size 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And the first operation, go through these operations in a sequential fashion. The first operation is NQ, this one, 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, and 9th. We have some more operations coming in the next slide. The first operation is NQ of 5. So initially rear is equal to front is equal to minus 1. Whenever you are inserting the first element, I told that you have to increment both rear and front. Therefore, rear and front is having a value of 0. That means rear and front are pointing to 0. At this location, you have to insert the element in such a way that it is Q of rear is equal to element. The element is 5, and Q of rear, that is Q of 0. Q of 0 is nothing but this location, right? So Q of 0 becomes 5. Next one is NQ of 3. The second operation is NQ of 3. Here he is saying to NQ 3. So what happens? Since the Q is having an element, now there is no need to increment the rear point, front pointer. The thing is that you have to increment only the rear pointer. Therefore, rear is pointing to location 1. And then you have to execute this instruction. Q of R is equal to element. That is, Q of 1 is equal to 3. Therefore, it becomes 3. Okay. Now, let us go for the DQ operation. DQ means there is no need to specify which element to be deleted. By default, the DQ operation will remove the element from the front part. So, what you have to do? You increment front such that it points to the first location. That is the DQ operation. As I told that this is a logical deletion only. Therefore, the elements are not deleted in the memory. But for our convenience, what we will do is, we will assume that 5 has been deleted. But remember that the original 5 will not be deleted from the queue. Right. So next, NQ of 7. I won't go for this rear and front pointers. You can assume that these things. So this is rear and NQ of 7. Next, DQ means whatever element that is pointed by 3, that will be deleted. Whatever element that is pointed by F, that will be deleted. Therefore, 3 is deleted. This is done by incrementing the F. Therefore, at this particular point, both F and rear are pointing to the same location. So, how can you test whether a queue is having a single element? This concept is very simple. If rear is equal to F, whenever the condition, this condition satisfies, rear is equal to front, that means in the previous class, in the previous instruction also, you have seen that both front and rear are pointing to 3 only, right? There exists only one element. Similarly, in this situation also, the front and rear are pointing to the same single element, that is 7. So this is how you check whether the queue consists of single element or not. How can you check whether the queue is empty or not? Queue is empty. Yesterday we have discussed it. Queue is empty is a condition where you can check it like this. If front is equal to rear is equal to minus 1. If this condition is satisfied, if both rear and front are pointing to minus 1, then that is the concept of queue empty. That is the condition for queue empty. How can you check the queue is full? Since it is a linear data structure, since it is a linear array or linear queue, whenever rear is equal to max minus 1, what is this max? Nothing but the size of the array. For example, here the queue size is taken as 6. That means max is equal to 6. Therefore, max minus 1 becomes 5. Whenever rear is equal to 5, then it is said to have the queue is full. So, these are the conditions for linear array or linear queue. So, DQ means 3 is deleted and there is only one element that is being pointed by both front and rear pointers, that is 7, right? Front, it is a special operation where it displays, it won't make any modifications, right? It won't delete the element from the queue. It just displaces what is there in the front. The front is pointing to the element 7, therefore that is being displayed, right? Next, DQ. DQ means you have to remove this single element. So, whenever you want to delete the single element, what you will do? You have to make this rear and front pointed to minus 1. After deleting the single element, what you have to do? You have to again bring back this rear and front pointer to point to minus 1. Now the queue is empty, right? Again, if you want to perform a DQ operation, 8th instruction, DQ, this is nothing but queue underflow. So, in this example, we have discussed all the concepts of enqueuing, dequeuing and queue underflow, right? So, whenever this is a empty queue and you want to perform a dequeue operation, right? So, I have discussed the queue underflow condition saying that whenever you want to remove an element from an empty queue, that condition is called as queue underflow, which is nothing but an error that is displayed, right? Is empty is again a supplementary function, which is saying that whether the is empty or not. If the queue is empty, it will simply return a true value. If the queue is not empty, it returns a false value, right? Since the at this particular point the queue is empty, and if you call this is empty function, it will simply return true. Let me go for the more examples. And as a 10th instruction, it is NQ, and 11th instruction is NQ of 7, and 12th instruction is size, one more supplementary operation, and 13th is NQ of 3, and 14th is NQ of 5, and 15th is DQ, right? So for the first two operations, that is 10th and 11th, that is NQ of 9, so it becomes, the first element is 9, and the second 11th operation is NQ of 7, it is 7, and the next operation that is performed is size. Size is a supplementary operation. So at this particular point, you can observe that front is pointing to 9 and rear is pointing to 7, right? The 12th instruction that is executed is size. Size is a supplementary operation which gives the total number of elements that are present inside the queue. Therefore, it consists of two different elements. The size is being displayed as 2. This is 1. 2. Right? The output is 2. Coming to the next two operations, that is 13th and 14th instructions, it is NQ of 3 and NQ of 5. Let us NQ it. So NQ of 3 is done first and then NQ of 5 is done next. So my rear pointer is pointing at this point in this position. Right? And the last instruction that is executed is PQ. PQ, right? PQ means you increment the front pointer such that it is removed and front is pointing here, right? So the last, after performing all these operations, the elements that are present inside the queue are 7, 3, 5. So these are the expected questions, like probability is there to get such type of questions, that after making some different NQ and DQ operations, he may be asking you what are the elements that are present in the stack, like 7, 3 and 5 are the elements. Or he may ask you what is the size of the queue, that is 3. Why? Because there are 3 elements in the queue, right? 7, 3 and 5. Or he may ask what is the front, is front, like what is front? If you call front, the first element that is being displayed is 7, right? Like this you may get some questions. So this is how a good example which we have discussed. And coming to applications of queues, right? There are three different applications which I am going to discuss. One is the job scheduling, second one is round robin schedulers, and the third one is priority queues. Most of the time you may not be asked questions on these applications, but you should know the concept, you should know the basics. What are the applications of queues? For example, you may be asked a direct question like prior to queue, one of the application of queues can be option A, priority queue, option B, conversion of infix to postfix, option C, evaluation of postfix. Like that you may be asked some question. That is a direct question where you can answer it directly, right? You can get the solution in a fraction of seconds, right? In such case, you should know what are these applications. We have discussed the stack applications like converting the infix to postfix or nested parentheses or converting the infix to prefix and evaluation of postfix, conversion of postfix to infix and conversion of prefix to infix. All these things we have discussed. There are a lot of applications of stacks. And coming to applications of queues, we will discuss three different applications, that is job scheduling, round robin scheduling, and the third application is priority queues, right? So coming to the first application, that is let me go to the general applications or the real life applications of queues. And one thing you can observe in queues is, dear students, please remember that most of the applications of queues in computer science world, you will find it in the operating systems, right? most of the time in computer science you'll find applications in the operating systems concepts only. Like you will have queue of processes, that means the operating system will maintain a queue for the processes, or else it may maintain a queue for IO requests. Like for example, you have some 4 different employees in an organization and there is only one printer that is being shared by all these employees, right? For example, he is employee 1 and he is employee 2, employee 3 and employee 4. Assume that employee 1 has given the print job, later employee 2 has given, and later employee 3 and then employee 4, right? All these things will be kept inside a job queue or a process queue or IO request queue, right? It depends on the situation where you are using, but the queue concept is same. When are you have more number of things and when are you want to schedule them based upon some criteria, then what you have to do is you have to make all those things to be placed in some locations. That locations are, that memory is nothing but the queue, right? So most of the applications in computer science you will find in the operating systems concept. But while coming to the real life examples, waiting in line, whenever you go to a movie, you want to buy a ticket, then you have to move into the queue. Okay, you cannot go to the front of the queue and you cannot take a ticket, right? Similarly, waiting on hold for tech support. For example, if you have called some customer care of BSNL or Airtel like that, then you will be getting announcements like this, like, your call is important for us, you are in a queue, please wait, right? So whatever calls they receive, they will put it inside the queue and they will be served in a FIFO manner, right? That's the purpose of FIFO, that's the purpose of using the queue. Why? Because the queue operates in a FIFO manner. That means whoever comes first, he should be served first. Otherwise, that will be a problem for the real life example. So whoever comes first in the for the service, they will be served first, right? And in the waiting lists, right? For example, you take the railway reservation system. You find the, for example, you book the ticket and you find that the waiting list is 43. What does this 43 mean? That there are 42 people before you who needs the service. That means who are waiting for the confirmation purpose, right? So after these 42 people got confirmation, then only you will be serviced. That means then only you will get the confirmation. Otherwise, you won't get the confirmation. Similarly, bureaucracy. Bureaucracy is nothing but the government organizations. It is a general tendency that they will follow the bureaucracy. That means they will have the pending files, right? So for example, you move to the government office with a file and there are some 100 files pending over there. Your file will be kept at the end. Your file will be kept at the rear part, such that the first elements are the first files, the files that are preceding this last element or last file will be served first, and then you will get the chance of service, right? These are the real life examples that we come across. And coming to the applications related to computer science, as I told that most of the applications you will find in the operating systems concept. The job scheduling, like round robin algorithms, job scheduling makes use of the queues concept. Why? Because you have lot of jobs to be serviced by the CPU. The jobs are executed on the central processing unit. Therefore, the CPU is the critical resource. But we have only one CPU, but there are different jobs to be executed. In such case, what you have to do is one person has to serve lot of jobs, or one CPU has to service lot of jobs. In such case, you will put all those jobs coming to you or coming to the CPU inside a queue. And whenever the CPU is vacant or whenever the CPU is available, then it will take one by one job and then it will give the service, right? This is how the job scheduling works. Similarly, threads. The threads concept means one process is divided into number of threads, and those threads are again kept in a queue, which is serviced in a FIFO fashion, right? The accessing of shared resources. The example which I have given, the corporate example, where the 4 employees are there and there is a single printer that is shared by the 4 employees. That makes use of a queue concept, right? Similarly, multi-programming, if there are multiple programs that can reside in a single memory, all these things are kept in the queue, and then all those programs has to be serviced by the operating system in a FIFO fashion only. All these things are concepts related to, again, operating system only, OS. So queues have a lot of benefits in the operating system, right? So after completing these applications of queues, let me go to the explanation part of one application, that is job scheduling. So initially the front and rear pointer are initialized to -1. Here we have a queue with 4 elements, which is represented by Q0, Q1, Q2 and Q3, right? At this particular point, assume that job 1 has entered into the queue. So that should be placed in the first location, that is queue of 0 location. So if it is a first element that is to be inserted, then what you have to do? I told that this is not -1. You can implement it to -1, but you have to make both front and rear to point to 0. Therefore, both front and rear are pointing at this location, right? After that, in the second point, or assume that it is at 10 o'clock and at 10:02. Assume that another job J2 has been entering into the job queue. In such case, you have to increment the rear. You have to increment the rear such that it points to Q1, and J2 has to be inserted into Q1. Similarly, assume that at 10:05, another job J3 has entered into the queue. In such case, this is 0. You have to increment the rear such that it points to Q2, and J3 has to be inserted into Q2, right? Next, assume that at 10:10, job 1 has completed its execution. So it has to leave the queue. Why? Because after completion, the jobs has to leave the queue such that it will give some chance to the other jobs to enter into the queue, right? So at this particular point, it is removed. Therefore, what you have to do? You have to increment the front pointer. So it becomes 1 and rear is pointing to same thing. And assume that at the latter point, like 10:12, the job 2 has completed its execution. Therefore, it is removed from the queue. And then it is removed by just making the front pointer to increment like this, right? This is front. So this is how the job scheduling works. The normal operation of a queue is similar to that of operation of a job scheduling, right? Now coming to the second application, which is nothing but the round robin schedulers, right? So this is a scheduling algorithm which we come across in the operating system subject, where the concept of round robin scheduling goes like this. We have a queue which we call it as job queue. As a type of application 1, we have discussed it, right? Let me have 4 different locations, 1, 2, and 3, and assume that each and every job is nothing but a particular task that is to be performed or that is to be completed. And that particular job has to be executed by the central processing unit. So whenever there is a job, there is a term called as burst time. So the burst time is nothing but the total time that is to be executed on the CPU by that particular job in order to complete its execution. For example, if I say that J1 is having 10 milliseconds, the burst time is 10 milliseconds. That means that J1, the job 1, takes 10 milliseconds to complete its execution. Similarly, assume that J2 is having 5 milliseconds. And let me take one more example, J3 with 1 milliseconds, right? Very small job, and J4 is some 6 milliseconds. So these are the burst times of different jobs. J1 with 10 milliseconds, J2 with 1 milliseconds, and J3 with 1 millisecond. That means J3 is the shortest job which can be executed in just 1 millisecond, right? And J4, assume that it is 6 milliseconds. Now, in the round robin scheduling, the name itself suggests that it is round robin. That means it is a scheduler which makes use of some rounding concept, and there is a concept called as time slicing. Time slice. or it is also called as time quantum also. Here you can find it, right? One time slice or one time quantum, it is of user choice. For example, let me take the time quantum as 2 milliseconds. This time quantum specifies the time frame for which a particular job has to be executed on the CPU before leaving the CPU, right? Let me have this thing, right? For example, J1 with a burst time of 10 milliseconds has entered the job queue. And since there are no jobs, it is placed as the first one, right? Now, assume that at the same time, J2 has entered and J3 has entered and J4 has entered. And we have some more locations like 4. So, according to round-robin scheduling algorithm, I am saying that the time quantum is just 2 milliseconds. So, what happens is the J1 will be allocated CPU. Assume that this is CPU. The J1 is allocated CPU and it starts its counter. It starts its counter. Okay. So after 2 milliseconds, after executing this job 1 on CPU for 2 milliseconds, it will be preempted. Preemption means it will be forcibly removed from the job. It will be forcibly removed from the CPU and it is placed back inside. Right. So after this 2 milliseconds, the remaining time for this J1 is 8 milliseconds. Right. Now comes the chance of J2, right? After J1 has executed for 2 seconds, it is preempted and it is placed at the last end of the queue. Now comes the chance of J2. Assume that J2 is having a total burst time of 5 milliseconds. Whatever may be the burst time of those jobs, it will execute for this particular time slice or time quantum of time only, right? So 2 milliseconds will be allocated. After 2 milliseconds, preempt it and then again push it onto enqueue it into the queue, right? So J2, after executing for 2 milliseconds, the remaining thing is 3 milliseconds and it will be enqueued into the job queue. And coming to J3, it is having only 1 milliseconds, but the time slice is 2 milliseconds. In such case, it will execute only for 1 millisecond and it has completed its execution. Therefore, there is no need to again enqueue this J3, right? So after completion of 1 millisecond, J3 has been completed and then the CPU is free to serve the J4, right? So J4, after executing 2 milliseconds, again J4 will be enqueued in this queue. Like that, this process executes and this round robin scheduling makes use of a concept called as queue, right? So this is what we have explained it. Maybe this round robin scheduling may make use of the circular queue. The circular queue we will discuss in today's class itself. It's a simple modification to the linear queue, right? Or linear queue, a simple modification, and the concept is important from gate point of view, right? So this is how the round robin scheduling works. That is, in the first part, you have to dequeue the next element. Dequeue the element and then get it serviced and then enqueue the serviced element if it has any burst time or if it has any remaining execution time, right? So this is the end of the second application, that is round robin scheduling algorithm. And the third one is a direct, very simple application, that is priority queues. We know what is a queue. A queue is a linear data structure where insertions will be done from one end and deletions will be done from the other end. But what is this priority queue? It is also a queue. There is no difference. It is better that we should not say that there is no difference. There is a small difference, but it is also a queue where insertions and deletions will be done at rear and front part respectively. So insertions will be done at rear part and deletions will be done at the front part. There is no difference. But the difference is each and every element in the priority queue will have some additional information. That additional information is called as a priority. So each and every element will have some priority. So for example, if you take element 10 or job 1, I say that the priority is just a simple number ranging from 1 to something like that, right? 3, 4, 5. You can assign this one as the highest priority, or you can make it as the lowest priority. If it is lowest, then 5 becomes the highest priority, right? If 1 is the highest priority, then it becomes the lowest priority, right? So you take 1 as the highest priority. So if I assign J1 as 1, that means this J1 is having the highest priority. And for example, each and every element will be having some priority number, right? Assume that J1 is having 4, that means the last but one priority, right? And J1, and assume that J2 is having last priority, that is 5. And now this is my front part, right? And this is my rear part. Now assume that there exists there is a job J3 with a priority of 1, which is of very highest priority, and it wants to enter into this job queue. This is job queue, and it wants to enter into the job queue. In such case, what you have to do is you have to rearrange the elements. Why? Because J3 is having the very high priority, and that particular job has to be serviced first rather than servicing the J1 and J2. And here comes the first one, J3 with priority 1, and then J1 with priority 4, and J2 with priority 5. This is my way, right? So whenever a job is entering into the queue with highest priority, then that particular job has to be executed first. If that job has to be executed first, then it is the you have to make some rearrangements in the queue such that the highest priority job always stays in the first, always stays as the first element, right? So this is how the adjustments will be done. But if you want to delete, this is the, you are deleting from the front part only, right? But insertions, while inserting, you are not inserting at the rear element. This is the important difference between a priority queue and a queue, right? So in queues, insertions are always done at rear end, and deletions are always done at front end. But in priority queue, remember that deletion always done at front part only, but insertion may not be in the rear part. This is not happening in the rear part. Whenever you want to insert an element into the queue, you have to make the rearrangements. But if the entering element is something having the lowest priority than the jobs that are present inside the queue, then you can simply insert it at the rear part only. There is no difference between the queue and priority queue. Priority queues comes into existence whenever you want to insert a job, or whenever a job is trying to insert itself with the highest priority. In such case, there should be some rearrangements, right? For example, let me take another thing. That assume that J4 is coming into the job queue, which is having a priority of 2, right? Already there is job 3, which is having 1 in the front part, and job 1, which is having a priority of 4, which is present as the second element, and J2 as the third element. You have to insert this J4 here. That means after 1, you have to, after priority 1, the next job has to be, it has to have the priority of 2, right? Therefore, J4, it becomes 2, and it is J1 with priority 4, and this becomes J2 with priority. This is how it makes itself, it makes rearrangements of itself, right? So that's the concept of priority queue. A priority queue is an abstract data type, which is like a regular queue data structure. But additionally, every element is having a priority associated with, right? In a priority queue, the element with high priority is to be serviced first before an element with a low priority is serviced. If two elements, this is important, if two elements have the same priority, then they will be served according to their order in the queue. For example, J1 and J2 both are entering into the job queue. They both are trying to enter into the job queue. Or else, for example, J1 with one priority, that is highest priority, is already present inside the queue. right? Let the priority be 2 and assume that J2 with same priority 2 is entering into the job queue. In such case, since both J1 and J2 are having the equal priority, what you should do is you have to put this J2 at the end of J1 itself, right? Why? Because J1 has entered into the job queue, therefore it follows the FIFO order or first come first serve, which is FCFS, right? All these terminologies are same, one and the same, and you will come across in the operating systems concept, right? So coming to priority queue, the idea behind the priority queue is very simple. It is a queue which is where insertions is done at the rear part if the priorities are less or more, priorities are less than the elements that are present inside the queue, and you always remove from the front. There is no discussion about this. But the items are ordered by a key. The key is nothing but the priority. So it implies that your position in the queue may be changed by the arrival of a new item. So whenever a high priority, for example, if you go for a darshan, temple darshan, right? For example, if any MLA or MP or CM visits the temple, then he has to be given highest priority, and then he will be made darshan very quickly by stopping the remaining elements. That means you have to stop the remaining jobs and then you have to give priority to the CM or MP or whatever it may be, right? So that is where the priority queues will be used. So it is used in scheduling queues for a processor, and it is also used for print queues. That means there are some jobs which has to be printed with highest priority. In such case, the priority queues can be used. So a priority queue is no longer a FIFO. As I told that deletions are always done from front part, but insertions are not into the rear part, right? Why? Because while inserting an element, you have to rearrange the elements based upon the priority of the incoming element, right? So you still remove it from the front. That's what we discussed. The priority queue is always done at the front part only, but insertions are governed by a priority. So this completes the application part, which is important for concepts point of view. And coming to implementation of queues, the next topic is implementation of queues, where you will discuss how you can implement these queues, right? Like stacks. Stacks can be implemented using two methods or two data structures. That is, stacks can be implemented either by using arrays or by using the linked list. The same is the concept with queues, right? The queues can be implemented either by using the arrays or by using the linked list. While you are using the arrays for implementing the queues, you can implement them in two ways. That is, the linear fashion, which is nothing but the linear queue, and you can implement the arrays in a circular fashion, which is also called as circular queue. The concept of circular queue is very important, right? We'll discuss within few minutes, right? Next, coming to implementation of queue using arrays. Why? Because we are not done with the concepts of linked list. Let us confine our discussion to implementation of queues using arrays only, right? So implementation of queues using arrays can be done in either in linear fashion or in a circular fashion. Let us take an array of size n. These are all things we have discussed, right? I'll just go through it and you have to catch those points, right? In a regular fashion, or it can be implemented in a circular fashion, we have two pointers, that is front and rear. Front is to point to the front element and rear is to point to the rear element, right? So this is how a normal configuration looks like. Normal configuration means linear queue. This is an example of linear queue, right? So this is how the queue looks like. It starts with 0, 1, 2, and assume that these white boxes are the queue with no elements, and these colored boxes, these violet colored boxes, are the queue consisting of elements. Therefore, this queue consists of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10 elements, right? Even though the size of this array is something around 17, but there are only 10 elements that are present inside the. For example, in this linear fashion, in this linear cube, you insert one more element, therefore you block it, right? And you insert one more element, block it. We insert one more element, block it. Now the rare is pointing here. So what is the condition to check for Q full, which is nothing but rare is equal to max minus 1, right? So since rare is pointing to the last location, which is nothing but 16, what happens? It will say that the Q is full, but you can observe that the front part of the Q from index 0 to 3 are empty. Even though the array or the queue is having some empty locations, you are unable to access these locations. That is the disadvantage of linear queues. This is called as, what do we say, if the queue is full and if you want to try to insert a new element, it is nothing but queue overflow, right? So if the stack, if the queue is full and you try to insert a new element, that is called as queue overflow condition. But here the queue is not full. If you look at the front part of the queue, there are 4 vacant locations where you can insert the new elements. But according to this condition, r is equal to max minus 1, it is saying that the queue is full. So this situation is called as false overflow condition. This situation is called as false overflow condition, right? So the disadvantage of linear queues is false overflow condition. You may be asked a question, a direct question like, in implementing linear queues, the following may be the disadvantages. That is false overflow condition, false underflow condition, or something like that. So if you know this particular concept, then only you can answer this particular type of questions, right? So in order to, this is the disadvantage of linear queues, that is false overflow. False overflow means even though there are vacant positions in the front part of the queue, since the rare is meeting the condition where rare is equal to max minus 1, it is meeting that such condition, it is showing that the queue is full, which is nothing but a false overflow condition. In order to avoid this false overflow condition, they have come across with a new concept called as circular queue. Right? This circular queue, what we call it as wraparound configuration. What we'll do is, after this last element, we assume that this last element, after this last element, we assume that the last element is again linked to the first element, right? This is nothing but wrapping of the circular queue, wrapping of the linear queue, which represents a circular queue. So after this condition, rare is equal to max minus 1, it is again pointing to the zeroth location. This happens, this we will discuss what is the condition for queue full and queue empty in the circular queue. So this is how we avoid the things, right? After this element is full, then if you want to insert an element, then it will automatically point to the zeroth location, and since the zeroth location is vacant, you can insert the element easily. So this is called as wrapped around configuration, or which we call it as circular queue, right? I'm just running through these slides. This is an example of queue which consists of some predefined size, and it consists of 3 elements, that is 4, 8 and 6, right? So the front is pointing to which one? It is 0, and rear is pointing to 2. What is the size here? 3, right? Size can be easily found by rear minus f plus 1. This is a simple formula, right? How can we find the size of the array? So you take the rare index and you subtract the front index, that is 2 minus 0, and you have to add one more element, right? That is 2 minus 0 plus 1, that is 3, right? Therefore the size is 3. This I have already explained. So there are three elements. Front is pointing to 0 and rear is pointing to first and last. You can call it in either way, right? First is 0 and last is 2 and the size is 3. And I have given the formula for size, right? The size, coming to next one, if you DQ one element, if you DQ, then what happens? While DQing, you increment the front point such that it points to 1. Therefore, front becomes 1 and rear becomes 2 and the size is, what's the formula that I have given? Size is equal to rear minus front plus 1, that is 2 minus 1 plus 1, that is 2. Therefore, the size is 2 elements, right? So, these are the conditions. You may be asked a question like this. How to find the size of the elements or the number of elements in a queue can be found by using the following condition, right? He will give different four options and you have to check the correct option, right? These NQ operation and all these things we have explained, right? This is one more example where he has taken 50 elements array. Therefore, the size of queue is, what is the size of the queue? The size of queue is 50. Therefore, you can insert 50 different elements, right? So, he is taking the pointers as head and tail. In the previous example, I have taken it as first and last. In the previous example, I have taken it as front and rear. Here, you are taking it as head and tail. It is a user's choice, right? You may be asked questions with different pointers. He may be telling you that the first element is pointed by a pointer X and the last element is pointed by pointer Y. Anything can be possible, right? So at this particular point, the queue is having three different elements. Therefore, head is pointing to 0 and tail is pointing to 2. After NQ operation, you increment the tail such that it is pointing to 3 and head is pointing to 0 and the size is 4, right? If you DQ operation, you increment the head such that it points here in this situation, right? And this is empty, right? And assume that there are 50 calls to the NQ. This is thing, right? Assume that there are 50 calls and therefore the queue is full. Why the queue is full? Why? Because it is satisfying the condition that rear is equal to max minus 1. If it is max minus 1, it is a overflow condition. Assume that after this condition, you have DQ'd 4 elements. That means you called DQ operation 4 times. Therefore, 0th element will be deleted, this one deleted, first, second, and this one will be deleted. Therefore, there are 4 vacancies. Even then also, since rare is equal to max minus 1, it is still saying that the queue is full, even though there are empty locations over here. So, this is the false overflow condition. So, the disadvantage, remember students, the condition, what is the disadvantage of linear queues is, it is nothing but a false overflow condition. How can we avoid this? The false overflow condition can be avoided by making use of a concept called as circular queue. So, the solution for false overflow condition is circular queue, right? So, it allows the head and tail to be moving targets, and when the tail ends up, this is important, when the tail ends up, it will again point to the front part, which is nothing but the empty slots. So, this is how we wrap the configuration or we wrap the linear array. So, next insertion will go into slot 0, which is nothing but 0th location, and tail tracks it. And you have to make use of the tail, which makes the track of it, right? Like this. So, at this situation, if you want to insert an element, this is a, what you have to do, you have to make the tail to point to this location. Right? How you can do this is by making use of an operator called as modulo division operator, or it is also called as remainder operator. reminder, right? How it is happening means, for example, if you take an integer n is equal to 5, right? For example, if I make it as 1 modulo 5, what is the remainder? It is 1. That means whenever you are pointing to first element, it is located in the first location. Similarly, 2 modulo 5, it is 2. 3 modulo 5, it is 3. 4 modulo 5, right, it is 4. 5 modulo 5, it is 0. So what is happening here? So here it is wrapping, right? For example, if you take one more example, 6 modulo 5, it is nothing but 1, right? So whenever, that means whenever you use the modulo operator on 5, the values always ranges from 1, 0, starting with 0 and ends with n minus 1. Similarly, if you take 10, the value ranges from 0 and ends with 9. If you take 50, the value ranges from 0 and ends with 49. After 50th element, 51 by 50, the remainder is 1. Again, it is coming back to this thing, right? Similarly, 52 modulo 50 second. Therefore, in order to get the wrapping condition, what you have to do is, you have to use a remainder function. You have to make use of a remainder function, right? I will tell you the condition for circular queue full and circular queue empty, right? This is very important. Let me go through this particular example again. Okay, so this is the situation, current situation, which raises a false overflow condition. And after one call to NQ, what happens? Since you are making it as a wrap around configuration, this last location should be pointed to here, right? After this, you place it here. Therefore, tail should point here. Right, you have to make like this, tail modulo division n. So the location is, tail is such that it points to 0, right? So after one more call to nq, again tail is incremented, right? So that it points to 1. Like that, you have to continue the configuration, right? I think I am clear about this, and let me give the condition for queue full and queue. So this is very important. Remember students, this particular concept and what I am discussing now, what is the condition for circular queue full and circular queue empty? First one, circular queue full and circular queue empty. These two conditions are very important. You may be asked some direct questions on this. There is one question which is directly asked in the previous examinations also. So for a circular queue full condition, what you have to do is, that is, it is rare plus 1 modulo division size is equal to. If this condition is satisfied, remember this is very important condition, circular queue full condition, there is a question that is being asked in the previous gate questions and this is important also. If this condition is satisfied, that is rare plus 1 modulo division size is equal to friend. If this condition is satisfied, then we can say that it is a full condition for the circular queue, right? For example, you take this same example. Assume that this is rare. Let us don't confuse with this terminology. Assume that you insert one more element. This is inserted. One more element inserted. One more element inserted. Now one more element inserted. Now my rare is pointing to which location? 3, right? Now let us check whether now the queue is full, right? Now we'll check whether this condition is satisfying or not. That is, what is rare? Rare is 3 plus 1 modular division. What is the size? Size is nothing but the total size of the cube. That is nothing but 50, right? 50. What is the value here? 4 modular division 50, which is nothing but 4, which is nothing but parent, right? So if this condition, that is rare plus 1 modular division size is equal to parent, if this condition is satisfied, then you can say that the circular cube is full. Out of these two conditions, this condition is very, very important. You remember, you put many stars. How many stars you can put? You can put. It is of your choice. But this condition is very important. Either you by heart it or you learn the concept. I have discussed the concept how this condition is being satisfied for a circular cube full, right? So you can by heart it, or better, I don't suggest students to by heart these particular formulas or something like that. You apply the concept. Like you take a small array of size, some 1, 2, 3, 4, right? In order to make this cube full, for example, assume that this is F, and you know these two elements are vacant, and this is full, right? 10, 20, 30. You insert one more 40 here. Right, 40, and you insert 50 here. This is the situation where the cube is full. Therefore, rare is pointing here. So how you can make it, right? For example, rare is equal to, or you can also write it as friend is equal to rare plus 1. This is also true. But this is the actual formula which satisfies all the conditions, right? For example, if you take this formula, F is equal to rare plus 1, F is 2, where rare is 1 and you add 1, therefore this is satisfying the condition. But this condition may be fail in some cases. But this particular condition where you are using the modular division, without using modular division, the wrapping condition will not be satisfied. So in order to wrap, you have to make use of the modular division operator, right? So rare plus 1 modular division size is equal to friend. This is the condition where you have to satisfy, that is to be satisfied if you have to make the circular cube as full, right? Now what is the condition for circular cube empty? Circular cube empty means friend is equal to rare is equal to minus 1. There are some other conditions where it can be satisfied, but remember that the circular cube full condition is very important. That is rare plus 1 modular size is equal to friend. So this is again the same concept. Drawback of linear cube is false overflow condition, which is nothing but even though there are empty locations in the friend part of the cube, you are unable to enqueue those elements. That is the fault, and that is called as false overflow condition. And you can avoid that false overflow condition using a concept called as circular cube. Okay, and remember that this is just for our imagination purpose. In original, in the actual concept, don't assume that the memory is located in a circular manner, right? It is a linear memory cells that are situated, and for understanding purpose, we will make use of this particular circular concepts, right? You assume that the locations are in the circular location. For example, if you take this one, this is the 0th index and it is the last index, that is 7. Therefore, after 7, it is pointing to 0. Therefore, I have made a circle like this, right? So there are 6 different elements where friend is pointing to 23 and rare is pointing to 50. So these are all the things. If it is initially empty cube, rare is equal to friend is equal to 0. Why? Because the index starts with 1. If the index starts with 0, then you can make it as rare is equal to friend is equal to minus 1, right? So insert 10. Rare becomes 1 and friend becomes 1. Therefore, both of the things are pointing here. Similarly, insert 50, rare is incremented and it is pointing to 2 and friend is equal to 1. Similarly, insert or enqueue 20, rare is equal to 3, friend is equal to 0. Enqueue 70, rare is equal to 4, friend is equal to 1. Delete, that means nothing but dequeue. Dequeue means you have to delete the element which is pointing by front. Therefore, front is pointing to 2 and rear is pointing to 4. This is how the circular queue operates, right? So the array implementation of queues is very easy to implement, and it has fixed size, and it has special behavior is needed whenever the rear reaches the last end of the queue. The best point in implementing the queues using arrays is the arrays are very easier to implement, but the disadvantage is they have some fixed size. Why? Because it is static memory allocation, right? And the last concept which I want to discuss, we are left with one more important concept. So let me end this particular topic by discussing this double-ended queue, and this implementation of queue using stack is very, very important concept. You got a few questions in the previous GATE examinations also, right? So we'll discuss it in the next class, but for time being or for today's class, let me end my today's session with double-ended queues, right? So what is a queue and what is a double-ended queue? A queue is something like where insertions are done at rear end. This is fixed. And deletions are done at front end. So the insertion and deletion are fixed. It has constraint that you have to insert the element at the rear part of the queue only. And then you have to insert the element at the or delete the element at the front part only, right? So in such case, what is the difference between this double-ended queue? Double-ended means you won't have any restrictions on insertions and deletions. That means insertions, for a double-ended queue, insertions can be done at rear end or front end. There is no restriction that you should insert only at the rear end. And for the deletion part, it is same. Either you can delete from the front or you can delete from the rear. That is the meaning of double-ended queue. You can make operations from any end, right? So we have right. So the double-ended queue differs from queue abstract data type or first in, first out or FIFO. Why? Because you are not inserting the, you are not operating in the FIFO manner, right? We'll see. So a double-ended queue is an abstract data type that generalizes the queue. Why you are generalizing it? That means you are not putting any restrictions on insertions and deletions. You can insert at any end and you can delete from the any end. For which elements can be added or removed from either the front or the back. So insertions and deletions can be done at both the ends. So that is the meaning of double-ended queue. It is also called as head-tail linked list, right? And it is abbreviated as DQ. So this DQ is different. This DQ, capital DQ, is double-ended queue. But there is another term which we have come across in the previous slide, that is DQ, which we represented with a small letter D. This is nothing but deletion. Right, this double-ended queue, capital D stands for double-ended queue, right? It is pronounced as DEC. It's not DQ, it's pronounced as DEC. And there are different types of DQs, which is called as input restricted DQ. We can understand from this term that DQ, it is a DQ where input is restricted. What do you mean by, in general, DQ means insertions will be done from rear and can also be done from front. Similarly, deletions can be done from rear and can also be done from front end. Right? This is what double-ended queue we have discussed. But input restricted means we will restrict the queue while insertion. What is the default insertion? We will be inserting at the rear end. Therefore, we will remove this front part. So whenever a DQ is defined in such a way that the insertions are always restricted at the rear end, but there is no restriction on the deletion, that means you can delete from the rear end or the front end, it is called as input restricted DQ. You have restrictions on the output, right? So a double-ended queue, insertions can be done from rear and front. Similarly, deletions can be done from rare and friend. Right. But here you are output, you are restricting the output. That means by default the deletion should always be done at friend part, right? So you won't make the deletions to take place at the rare part. So if you restrict the DQ such that the deletion will always takes place at the front end and there are no restrictions for the insertion, that is you can insert either from the rare or friend, that particular thing is called as the output restricted DQ, right? So this is one important concept that we have discussed, and this is the concept which takes just 5 to 10 minutes. Why? Because we are not concentrating on the programming part. Programming is not important for the gate point of view, from the gate point of view. So this particular topic is very important. You have a lot of questions from the previous gate examinations, few questions from the gate examination, and there is a high probability that these type of questions can be asked in the coming gate questions also, gate question papers also, right? So implementation of queue using stack, how you implement using a queue using stack, that we will discuss in tomorrow's class. So that's all for today's session. Hope I have cleared all the concepts and hope I have cleared all the queries that has queried by my students, and hope you have learned lot of things in today's class. And tomorrow again we'll meet at 10:30. We'll start our discussion with implementation of queue using stack. We'll end this thing and then we'll start the new concept called as linked list, right? In linked list we have lot of concepts that needs to be discussed, and maybe the applications parts of linked lists I will skip for tomorrow's session. That means I start with the basics of linked lists. And then I discuss all these advantages, disadvantages, and the basic concepts I'll discuss, and I'll discuss the singly linked lists as well as the operations on linked lists. Remember students, whenever you come across the linked list term, it by default it is called as a singly linked list, right? We have different types of linked lists which we will discuss in the tomorrow's session, right? And the time complexities of singly linked list, this is very important. We'll discuss with a table how these time complexities of this singly linked lists are calculated, and you may be asked a lot of questions on this singly linked list, right? On the time complexity of singly linked list, we'll discuss this thing. And then we'll go through the doubly linked list, and if time permits, time to discuss the applications, I'll discuss these two applications like polynomial ADT and sparse matrix ADT. And if there is no enough time, then I'll skip these two things. Why? Because there is no much importance for these applications, but I'm sure that I will discuss these things in the later sessions when I find some time for it. But for tomorrow's, my target is to complete the entire linked list concept, so that we'll be completing 5 days of sessions, and we are having almost seven more sessions, right? So the trees concept is very important, as I discussed in the first day session, and it almost takes 2 to 3 sessions to complete the trees concept, especially trees. And you have to concentrate the trees concept, very easy concept if you know the concept. And hence, so tomorrow 5th day I am going to end this 3rd part. We are almost done with the 2nd part. That means stacks are completed, queues we have completed, and tomorrow the 3rd day, we are 5th day, we are going to complete the linked list. And from the 6th, 7th, 8th, all those 3 days I am planning for trees concept, right? And then graphs and hashing, it almost takes 1.5 session, right? 1.5 day or 2 days, right? So complete 10 days for discussion on the concepts, and 11th day I will make the practice session. There are about 60 to 70 questions which we will practice, and you will get lot of confidence, that's for sure. And the 12th day, the last day, is gate examination previous questions. Almost 100 questions need to be discussed, and maybe I try to complete the phase 1 within 9 days, right? So that I can make use of 3 days for practice and as well as gate questions. And that's all for today's session. And let me have one reminder that Today I will upload a link. Why? Because we have completed two different topics and I want to test you on the basic concepts, how much you have understood the basic concepts of stacks and queues. So you will be uploaded a test link. Those whoever is interested, they can take the test, which consists of just 10 questions, very simple questions. You will get confidence about it and then you have to submit it, and after submitting the score will be displayed, and if there are any queries in those questions you can pose me, and if there are any concepts to be explained in those questions I will definitely explain those things. And today, by today evening or by today afternoon, you will come across this particular link, and those whoever is interested, I request the students to go for the topic wise test on stacks and queues. Right, so that's all for today. Thank you one and all. Thank you for your patience listening, and thank you.